Completed my computer engineering from BJTI Mumbai in 2019, and I've been working as a software developer for SAP for the past 1 year. And let me tell you, I was very, very happy to see so many people are excited to start the course, and I'm equally excited to teach you guys Python. So before moving in, I wanted to tell you guys how the session is going to go. So before starting with Python, I will give you an introduction of what programming means, what algorithms are, and then we will move into Python. And the usual this the flow of the session would be that after the 2 sessions of 1 week, right, I will be giving you some assignments to solve. Some questions that related to the stuff that we have seen on these 2 days of the week that you will need to solve. And then you'll have to bring it in the next session. And then we will discuss about it in the next session. Okay, so is this clear? And also, if you have any questions in between, when we are going through any topic, and if you think you are not able to understand it, so feel free to just ask question midway. No, stop me and ask the question. That is fine, because that concept should be understood by you. That is the most important thing. Okay, so is any one has any doubts, or should we move ahead?
You can
Go
move
ma'am.
ahead, ma'am. No,
Okay, cool.
no. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I'll be presenting my screen.
Hey Priya, this is Shaina. I just joined on this
Hey, hi,
bridge.
Shana.
Yeah. So, have you guys started? How's it going?
Yeah, I'm just starting.
Yeah, hi. Yeah, it's just starting. We were just interacting and introducing
Yeah.
ourselves. So yeah, it's just starting right now.
Okay. So sorry guys, sorry to join a little late. I was this link got changed, right? The Meet link. So I just got to know about this. Okay, so I guess you guys must be knowing that Priya will be mentoring us for the English sessions, right? I guess you guys must have got introduced, right?
Yeah,
Yes,
yeah.
yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, so you can start. Let me know if anything is needed from my side.
Sure, Shani. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Is my screen visible for you guys, and is it coming as a complete PPT or?
It is visible.
Okay,
Yes,
you are
ma'am, we
able
can
to read
see.
the content, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, cool. Okay, so now I see you guys are so excited about learning in Python, but I want you guys to first tell me, do you have any idea what programming means? Any one of you, if you even if a little idea you have about it, what does programming mean? You know, Python is used for programming, but what is programming? What is this black box programming? Anyone? Or should I assume that no one has any idea about programming? Okay.
I think programming depends on code,
Okay.
as then it will work.
Okay. Fine. That is great. Yeah. So basically, we code to write a program, and that's how it works. But what is a program used for?
To instruct a computer to
Communicating to
what to
computer.
do.
Yes. That's great. Yeah. So basically, any device, right? Any device like a laptop or a mobile phone, anything that you want to communicate with, that you want it that device to do something for you, you will have to program that device first. Okay. So let's take an example. Now, if you are playing a video game on your laptop, so all you have to do is just open the laptop and play the game. Hit on some keys and move left and right to play the game. But the computer has to understand your input, right? The computer has to know that when you click on the right button, it has to do a certain action. It has to move right. But the character in your game has to move right. Or if you when you're clicking the left button, the character has to move left.
Okay, so this is what the computer needs to be instructed. Okay, so when you click on left and right button to play the game, you're basically playing, you're the user, you who's playing the game. But then there has been something, there is a code inside that computer which will instruct it that when you get a right button, you move the character to the right. And when you get a left button click, you move the character to the left. So basically, programming is nothing, but the computer is being instructed that certain steps have to be performed, certain instructions that you, human, want to give to the computer. That is why programming is used. It's just a way to instruct the computer to perform certain tasks. Okay, so does anyone have any doubts in this, like what is programming? Now this is very basic, like what is programming? It's just a way in which you are communicating to the computer. You are telling the computer to do certain things for you.
I have heard about binary codes, that is 0 and 1. So that means the binary code are the algorithms.
No. I'll tell you what binary code means. Just a minute. We'll go one by one, step by step, and I'll tell you what binary code is. Okay. Any doubts about what is programming right now? Like, did you guys get a basic idea of, okay, this is programming? Okay. If I'm writing a code, this is what my code will do. It will instruct the computer to do something for me. Okay. This is as simple as that. You're writing a code because you want the computer to do something for you. Okay, yeah, so now what are algorithms? Okay, so think of it this way. Now if I want to make a sandwich, okay, for instance, and I don't know cooking, okay, so what will I do? I'll open a recipe book and I'll see how to make a sandwich, and I'll follow the steps one by one. Okay, that is how I'll create a sandwich. Okay, so in same way, algorithm is nothing but a step-by-step instruction. So whenever you want to do something, okay. So can anyone who understood what algorithm means or who knows what algorithm means, give me an example. Like, for instance, I'll give you an example. If I wanted to be a part of this meeting, so what I did was I picked up my phone first, then I went on the Meet app, then I logged in with the meeting request, and then I got into the meeting. Okay, so these are basically the steps that I followed to join this meeting right now. So this is nothing but an algorithm. So if, for instance, if I wanted to create a sandwich, I'll first take a bread, then I'll put butter on it, then I'll put tomatoes on it, and then I'll put the second layer of bread on it. So this makes my sandwich. So this is like a step-by-step instruction to do a certain task. In the sandwich task, I wanted to make a sandwich, and for that I required certain steps, certain
Priya, you're not audible. Your voice is not audible. Can everyone hear Priya?
Am I ma'am. Audible now?
Yeah, it's fine now. It's fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Am I audible now to everyone, or is someone still not able to hear me? Okay, it's audible. Let me just go back to the PPT. Okay, and since I won't have access to the chat, so if you guys have any questions, just speak in between, okay? Yeah. So, am I still audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
cool,
ma'am.
Cool. So, now... Yeah. So, I assume now you know what an algorithm means. It is nothing but a step-by-step instruction to do whatever task you want to get done. Okay, if you want to make a sandwich, these are the steps, these are the step-by-step instructions that you will have to follow to make a sandwich. Okay. So, let's check. So, does anyone want to give me an example of algorithm of any daily thing that you do? Like, probably you came for the session. So, like, before coming to the session, you would have been, like, I don't know, sitting at your home and studying. So, what all steps did you follow to come from that point to attending this session? this or any other example that you want to give?
Ma'am, like a math problem, if you have to solve a math problem.
Yeah. So what? Okay, fine. So let's solve a math problem. If you want to add two numbers, what is the steps that you will use? What is the algorithm that you will use? Okay. Let me just go ahead. Okay. So if I want to add two numbers, what I'll do is, first I'll get those two numbers, right? I don't know what numbers to add. So my first task is to get what those two numbers are. Okay, so I can get it from a user if your teacher has asked you to add.
We have to go step by step. We have to follow the formula and then.
Anubha, your voice is breaking. I think there's some network issue. Okay. Anubha is trying to say something. She's trying to say something.
Yeah.
Is there anyone else who would like to complete what Anubha was saying? That what are the steps you will follow to add two numbers? Is there anybody who will want to help because Anubha is not audible because of network? Anybody else?
Ma'am, yeah. When we want to solve the math problem, first of all, we have to understand the question and then follow this and steps given in it. First, we have to get the given information from the problem. Mm-hmm. Then we have to use the formula and follow the steps and we'll get the answer.
Okay. That is cool.
This is what I think she is possible coming to say.
Yeah. So basically, whenever you want to solve a math problem, the basic thing is you will read the question and you will get the input. Input as in what all information is present for you, right? What all information can you work on? So if it's addition of two numbers, you know you have to add two numbers that is given in the question. Like those two numbers are given in the question. Then you will use the formula on it, A plus B or whatever number. If one number is 5 and the other number is 10, you will add 5 plus 10. And then you will give the output as the answer, which is 50. Okay. So these are the steps here, the algorithm basically. So similarly, when you want to get any work done from the computer or from any device, for that matter, you have a task, okay? You want it to do a certain thing for you, but you will have to give it step-by-step instruction, right? As we discussed before. So this step-by-step instruction that you'll give to the computer is called an algorithm, okay? So here you can see a diagram, right? A small diagram. So this is usually the convention that is used when you have to write an algorithm. Now, writing algorithm is not necessary when you are actually working with the code. What it does is it gives you an idea of what you want. So basically, if I start writing in Python and I decide, okay, today I'll write a game. Okay, and then I'm like, okay, I'll start writing in Python. But I still don't have exact idea of what all thing I require to do. What is the step-by-step process that I have to follow in order to write that code? Okay, so creating an algorithmic diagram like this flowchart, this is called a flowchart. So like creating a flowchart like this will give me better idea of what I am supposed to code. Okay. Is this clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So yes, here ma'am. In this flowchart, as you can see, there is an input. For every program that you write, there will be some input that you will be working on. Okay. If you're writing a game, for example, this laptop game that we talked about, in that game, whatever the user, like if you are the player who's playing the game, you are the user of the game, right? You will be using the game. So whatever input you are giving, like left button or right button, up button, down button, that is the input that the program has to work with. So every program that you write will have an input that it has to work on, do some magic on that input and give you the final output. So this is shown in this flowchart. You take the input, you do a certain set of rules on that input, you apply those rules on that input and you give the output to it. Okay. So there are two ways of representing algorithm. This is just for understanding purposes, so that you can get to write your code in a better manner. So first one, as we saw, was flowchart. Okay. So if anyone has any questions till now, you can just pop in between and ask the questions, okay? No issues with that. Okay. So this is to find a max of two given numbers. Okay. Now, see, when we are given questions like 5 and 10, which number of these is greater than that? So we kind of know that 5 comes before 10, so it is less than 10. Okay. But computer does not know that. Computer does not know anything, basically. It has the power to do things. It has good processing capacity. You give it 1,000 numbers and ask it to add all those 1,000 numbers in less than 1 second, it will do it. But it does not have its own brain. That's why you are supposed to code the computer and tell it to do one instructions one at a time. Okay. So
yeah,
here.
So Priya, I would just like to add an example here for all of you, what Priya was saying, that how it's very important to give very clear instructions to the computer. So just take an example. For example, you are going to buy curd from a shop. So you go to the shop and you say that you want Amul curd. Then the shopkeeper says that he does not have Amul curd. What will you do? You will make a judgment. Okay, if you don't have Amul curd, give me another brand Amul, give me other brand curd, right? But with the computer, this is not the case. So if, for example, if the computer is going to buy the curd and if you give the instructions to computer to buy Amul curd and then come back, computer will, if the shopkeeper says that he does not have Amul curd, the computer cannot ever make the judgment that to buy some other brand curd. So it's just an example that as human beings, we always have the power to make that judgment. But for computer, you have to be very, very specific in giving instructions, because whatever instructions you will give, the computer will follow that. The instructions you will not give, it will not make its own judgment.
Yeah, exactly. So as Manisha said, it does not have its own brain to make a judgment. Okay, you will have to give it every step that you want it to execute. So here in this case, as you can see, this is just a flowchart example. I just wanted to show you how a full flowchart looks like. So every code, as I said, will have an input. Okay. So let's consider the input as A and B. Okay. Right now, let's just consider it as A and B, which have some value, some numerical value. Forget about this A and B and think of it as 5 and 10. Okay. So the computer is taking instructions 5 and 10. Okay. And now it has to decide, is 5 greater than 10 or 5 is less than 10. Okay. So now here's the question, the task that you want the computer to perform is to find the maximum of two numbers, right? So if 5 is greater than 10, then 5 is the max number or 10 is the max number. Is this fine? Is this clear to everyone? Right? So now it will check if 5 is greater than 10. But is 5 greater than 10? No. So here, if you can see on the left hand side, there is a no bar, okay, which will say display B is larger, which means display 10 is larger. So what here, basically why this flowchart is being used is that for every step, right, wherever decision has to be made by the computer. Like in the case of going to a shop and buying curd, the decision that computer had to make was what if the shopkeeper has curd and what if the shopkeeper does not have curd. Okay, so like when you are writing the code, you will take into account every scenario. You will take into account, you can't just tell the computer go and buy curd. You will have to give it every scenario possible. You will have to instruct it what if the shopkeeper does not have curd and what if the shopkeeper has curd. Both the cases you will have to look into. So here exactly the same thing. So here, two numbers that you're giving, you will have to give the computer the instructions. What if A is greater than B, then what to do? That is, if 5 is greater than 10, then what you should do? And if 5 is not greater than 10, which means if the decision's answer is no, then what it is supposed to do? So like basically every decision, you'll have to instruct the computer in a certain way so that it is able to take into account every scenario. Is there any question?
Is there anybody here who would like to explain what Priya talked about now? Is there anybody who will like to say what have we discussed till now? Anyone? Because see, if you don't participate and don't tell her, it will be very, very difficult for her to understand then what are the things you are understanding. If you want her to like repeat anything, that is fine. But is there anybody, okay, let me know a fun question, that why is it important to give specific instructions to computer? Who can give me the answer to this question?
Ma'am, because as like we humans, a computer cannot decide on its own. It will only follow the instructions what we give it.
Yeah, good, Aishwarya. Anybody else who would like to add here? Anybody else would like to add here? It is very difficult, no? Otherwise, for us to understand that whether you are following or not.
Computer don't have its judgment power, so it's actually a programming gives all the decision for to be going through the whatever like user using is all computer programming. It's nothing computer is not using its brain. It's actually a man's brain who is being used by a programming or coding.
Okay, Sophia. Okay, thank you so much. If anybody has you want to say something? Okay. So till now, whatever Priya has told you, is there any doubt you have for one last time? Is there any doubt anybody is having? You would be happy. Please don't feel shy in asking questions. But it's very important that you learn properly, right? So if you have any question, any doubt, please ask that right now. I think, okay, Priya, like think... it's clear, so you can go ahead. Nisha, go ahead. You were asking something.
Ma'am, can you explain this once again?
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. See, Nisha has a doubt. So if anybody else feels that they are not able to understand it, you can please stop Priya and she will be happy to answer, like explain it to you 10 times. So don't feel shy about it. So yeah, Priya, you have, Nisha wants to know this again. I think you're on mute, Priya.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so see, whenever we are trying to code anything into the computer, whenever we are we want some task to be completed by the computer, we will have to take into account every scenario that can occur. So for example, as Manisha gave the example of asking your computer to go and get curd from the shopkeeper, right? So in this case, the shop when the computer goes to the shopkeeper, the shopkeeper may have curd or may not have curd, right? So these are two cases. Okay, now if you do not, when you're asking the computer to do this, when you're asking the computer to go and get curd, you have to specify every scenario that can occur. You have to specify, give it instruction ki if this happens, then do this. If this is not, if something else happens, how to handle that. So in this case, you'll have to tell the computer, if you go to the shopkeeper and ask for curd and the shopkeeper does not have curd, then does not have curd, then what is to be done? And if the shopkeeper has curd, then what is to be done? So if the shopkeeper does not have curd, then probably your computer can go to the next shopkeeper and ask for curd. And if the shopkeeper has curd, then the computer can buy from that shopkeeper itself. Okay. So it should, like, basically your computer does not have any brain to decide. You can probably, if your mother asks you to go and buy curd and the shopkeeper does not have curd, then you will have your own brain to go to some other shop and ask for curd. And if it's not there over there also, then you'll go to a third shop and check. But in this case, for computer, you will have to specify every single instruction. So as you can see in this flowchart, right, this is just you instructing the computer to find the maximum of two given numbers. So if your given numbers are 5 and 10, then you have to specify in your instructions what to do if 5 is greater than 10, which is that basically 5 is greater than 10, then what you are supposed to do, or if 5 is not greater than 10, then what the computer is supposed to do. So both these cases, you will have to instruct it to the computer. You will have to code it, every possible scenario. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So yeah, so here we saw the flowchart. There is one more way of writing this algorithm, which is pseudocode. And what does pseudocode mean? Which means it is not, pseudo is basically, which is not real, kind of artificial. So this is not like a real code. This is just an English statements to help you go through the code, to help you take one instruction at a time. So if you read this, you will exactly know what is to be done, and then you can write your code according to this. So this is just as a reference for you before you start writing your actual code. Okay, because it is easier to understand, right? If you write in Python, that would be a little harder for you to understand than writing in English, right? So whenever you have some idea in your head, okay, this is what I'm going to code. So first you will have to put it down as an algorithm, as a pseudocode. And then referring your pseudocode, you can start the actual coding. Okay, this is basically to make your coding easier so that you can go across the code easily. So this is the same program to find the max of two given numbers, and this is the pseudocode way of writing it. So here, see, like just like a recipe, just like instructions one after the other, it is written. Step one is to start. Step two is to read the numbers, two numbers. Step three is to check which number is greater. And so we'll go through all of this, but just English way of writing it is, if A is greater than B, then you do this. It is not greater than B, you do something else. Okay. So this is just a pseudocode. It's exactly the same task here we are following, maximum, finding the maximum of two given numbers. Okay. So should we move ahead? Or any doubts in pseudocode?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. No doubts.
Okay, cool. Okay. So now, why programming languages? So I think one of you was telling me about zeros and ones, right? Okay. So now, the computer does not understand any language apart from zeros and ones. It only understands, it's called binary. Zeros and ones is called binary. Why? Because only two numbers, right? Bi is two, so binary. Zeros and ones, okay? So now, see, I do not understand French, okay? And if some person comes to me and starts talking in French, will I understand it? No, right? If the person wants me to do something, they'll have to explain it in my language, in English probably. I'll understand English. So they'll have to explain it to me in English. Only then will I be able to do the task, right? So similarly, the machine, the computer or the mobile phone or any other device, right? Any device that runs on electricity will only understand two numbers, zeros and ones. Okay, so why are we writing this programming language is basically... Because this programming...
To communicate with the computer.
Yeah, right. To communicate with the computer, and internally, whatever programming languages you write, right? So if you're writing in Python, so internally that Python code gets converted to zeros and ones and the computer can understand it. Okay, this is just high overview. Why do you use a programming language? Because the programming languages are designed such so that it's easier to convert these languages into zeros and ones. Like probably if you write in English, like it is very tough to convert it into zeros and ones than converting programming languages. Programming language is like a link between you humans who understand English language or who understand a little higher languages and the computer who only understands zeros and ones. Okay?
Yes. Yeah, so I will just like to ask one question. So like as Priya said, that machines only understand zeros and ones, right? So if somebody asked us that if you have to communicate to the computer, you have to write in machine language, that is in the language of zeros and ones. So you think that we can do that from our end? Is it possible for us to write everything using zero and one as reference?
No, ma'am.
That's
why we are using programming code.
Yeah, yeah.
We can use compiler and interpreter.
Yes. You guys are completely right. That is the reason, because for us also to write in 0 and 1 is not possible. So programming language is a language which is understood by us humans also and also by the computer. So it is like a common link between you and the computer. Okay, it's clear, right? Yes, anybody, ma'am. Anybody yes, wants ma'am. To explain this before we move ahead? Anybody wants to do it? Guys, it's hello. It's very, very important for that. Important that you also participate and let us know that if you understood this or not. So, is there anybody who would just like explain in one line that why are we using programming languages?
Because communication link between hardware and software, between my and computer.
Yeah, Nisha. Yeah.
The computer can't understand our own language.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. So they are right. So as Nisha is telling, as Kanagarwal is saying, as Aishwarya is saying, all the other students, you are also requested that you also participate. If you have any doubt, if there is anything which is not clear till now, you can say it's not clear and we'll explain it to you again. Can we go ahead?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please do participate. Okay? Okay.
Okay, let's move ahead. So this is what programming is used for. So it is basically a way of talking to your machine, and telling it to do something in a way that the machine will easily understand. Okay. So there are always certain kind of errors in any program, in any code that you will write. You can expect certain kinds of errors that you make. Okay, so first is a syntax error. Now, what is syntax basically? Syntax is nothing but like a grammar. Like every language has a certain grammatical rules, right? In English also, you have certain grammatical rules. Like you might have learned it, right? Before any word that starts with A, E, I, O, U, you will always apply an, like an apple and a banana, something like that. So even these programming languages have certain grammatical syntax. Okay, so when you are writing a program, you have to take into account these grammatical syntax. You cannot make mistakes in this grammatical syntax of the programming language. Okay, so like if you write a little bit of here and there English, probably the reader will understand it. Like if you have written in your essay a apple instead of an apple, your teacher might understand it because fine, she has the capability to understand that. Fine, you did a small mistake, but you meant an apple instead of a apple. But here, as we talked, right, that the computer does not have its own brain and you have to tell it everything. Similarly, if you make any grammatical mistakes in writing code, the computer will not understand it. The computer will point it out as an error and your code will not run. Or in worst case, like it won't run only, first of all. Okay. So syntax is nothing but a basic grammatical, a basic grammar that your programming language needs to follow. Okay.
Fine. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so caught by compilers and interpreters. So let me just give you a little overview about what a compiler and interpreter is, since I think some of you already know what compilers and interpreters are. So see, whenever you write a code, okay, so as we discussed, right, this code that you write is in a programming language, is in Python, for instance, okay, but your computer only understands zeros and ones, okay. So now, how will the computer convert this Python language into zeros and ones? That's when compilers and interpreters come into the picture. They are like your helpers who are present inside the computer. They are softwares present inside your system, which will convert this written code, which will convert this Python code into zeros and ones so that the computer can understand it. Okay. Why we are using certain programming languages? To make it easier for the compilers and interpreters. If you write in English, the compiler and interpreter will not be able to make this connection between English language and zeros and ones. That's why you use programming languages like Java, Python, C++, which are easier for the compilers and interpreter to convert to zeros and ones. Okay? So is this clear what compilers and interpreters do?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Any question, just let me know. Okay, this is kind of important. So if you don't understand this, it won't be good. So that's why, if you have a question, if you don't understand it, just let me know. Okay. Okay, so second is logical errors. Okay,
So logical error is basically your mistake. It's not a mistake that the computer will point out. So like we said, right, in syntax error, if you write the wrong syntax, the compiler and interpreter will say, okay, I cannot convert this into zeros and ones, which means you have made a mistake. So for instance, if you take a person who knows French and English, okay, that person only knows French and English, okay. Now that person will read French and convert it into English for you. But if you give it wrong French syntax, that person, or some wrong, grammatically wrong French statement, the person will not be able to convert it to English, right? So in similar way here, the compilers and interpreters won't be able to convert your Python or whatever language you're writing in if your syntax is wrong. But in logical errors, your syntax is right? Your logic is wrong, syntax is right. So the compiler will not point out this code, this mistake. So what is logical error basically? Now, if you wanted to multiply, okay, if you wanted to get two inputs from the user, multiply it and then give the answer, but by mistake you did an addition instead of multiplication. Okay, so now this is your mistake, okay, and this is not a mistake that the compiler will understand, compiler or interpreter will understand, because for compiler and interpreter, multiplication is also valid valid syntax, and addition is also valid syntax. So it won't understand that you have done a mistake. So how can you find out logical errors? When you find the output. So if you're given 5 and 10 as input numbers, and you were expecting 50, but you got 15 in return as output. So this means you have to understand you have made some logical error somewhere. Okay? Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. And the third type is runtime error. Okay. Now I'll explain what runtime means later on. For now, just understand that runtime errors are something. When you're starting a code, okay. Now, if you are expecting two inputs from the user, if you are expecting two numbers to be given from the user, and you are going to divide these two numbers to get the output, okay. So now in this case, you do not know what the two numbers will be. The two numbers can be anything that the user will input, okay. So if that code is written, if I can type 0, I can type 10, I can type 9, I am the user, right, I can type anything, okay. So in this case, if you are dividing the two numbers that you're getting from the user, and so I think this is a basic mathematical rule that you cannot divide anything by zero. I'm sure you all are aware of it. If anyone's not aware of it, please let me know. It's a basic mathematical rule that if you divide any number by zero, it will return an answer of infinity, right? So that infinity is not defined in the computer language. You don't know what infinity is. The computer does not know it. So now when you're taking two numbers as input from the user, okay, and you're dividing it, and one of the denominator number turns out to be zero, now your computer does not know what to do. The answer is infinity, but your computer does not know what infinity is. So in that case, it will fail. So this is not a syntactical error because you did not know what the user was going to input. Okay, this is not a logical error because you wanted to do division. That's what you had done. But what you did not do here was to anticipate, was to like somehow know that the user is capable of giving zero as a denominator. So in that case, you should have taken into account the case wherein the user gave zero as an input. What will I do if the user gives zero as an input? So that you should have taken into account, which you will not find out unless someone actually puts in zero in the user input. So that's why it's called a runtime error. Why? Because when your code is running, at that point it will fail. Before that, you might not know it. You might not understand that this is the error. Is this clear to everyone? Can anyone to go through all the three errors and just give me one line? Probably one of you give me what syntax error means, someone else give me what logical error means.
Syntax error means which is a grammar mistake done by input terminal.
Done by? Sorry?
The grammar.
Done by user.
User, ma'am.
Okay, it's not done by user, it's done by a coder. Okay, now understand who is a coder and who is a user.
user is the one who will use your code. Okay, if you're writing a game application, user is the one who is going to play the application, like who is going to play the game that you have written. But you are the coder, you have written it, you are the developer, you have developed the code, right? Right? So in this case, syntax error is done by the developer, by the one who has written the code, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Anyone can give me what logical error means?
The logical error is the one of the programming error, which is then happen in unexpected behavior, and it will find difficult to source of error, and it will not caught by the compiler and the interpreter.
Yeah, it is unexpected behavior. But what is it? Like, can you give me an example of it?
Like here, the compiler and interpreters cannot identify that what is the mistake there.
Sorry? Can you repeat again, please? I could not hear you.
Here, the compilers and the interpreters are it will present in the computer. No, here, what happened in these logical errors, it cannot be identified by the compilers and the interpreters.
Yeah, that is fine. Yeah, compilers and interpreters can't find out that there is a logical error in the code somewhere. But like, can you give me an example of how can the logical error be present in a code? Anyone else? Like
we want to add some two numbers and we put the sign of multiplication. The result is the multiplication and we want the addition. So this is logical error.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And here, an apple in the place of an apple, if they've kept a apple, so it will...
Yeah, that was just an analogy. You will not type a apple and an apple in programming languages. But here, basically, if you make a mistake, you are the only one who can find out what the mistake is.
Okay. Instead of displaying a smaller number, it should display as a larger number.
Yeah, that is also correct. So if you're finding a minimum of two numbers, if you have 5 and 10 and if you want to find out what is the smaller one out of 5 and 10, but instead of giving the less than sign, you by mistake gave a greater than sign, then that will be a logical error. Because here the logic is wrong, right? You wanted to do something and you put some other logic. Fine? Okay. Anyone can tell me what runtime errors are?
Ma'am, runtime errors are not the error done by the coder. That the code will be correct in all syntax and all logics, but while the program is running, some conditions of the user maybe that will become an error. That is called a runtime error.
Yeah, good. So basically, the coder has to think in all the ways, okay? So this is also coder's mistake only. The point that he did not anticipate that the user can give some input, can give zero input.
Yes, ma'am. Error of the coder, but not any syntax error, ma'am.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. So basically, when you are writing a code, you have to take into account every scenario that can happen. Okay, that is like, that can make you a very good programmer. If you come to think of every scenario that of a task that you want to solve. If there is one task like division and you can think of all the scenarios, all the input, this numbers that the user can give and then code according to that, then it is considered a very good code. If your code can bypass all the inputs. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Let's go ahead. Okay, so I'll just walk you through PyDroid 3. I'm assuming most of you are using PyDroid 3, right? I'll just walk you through it and we'll see what that application has to offer. Is this visible for you guys, the PyDroid screen?
No, ma'am.
Not visible? Just a second. Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Okay. So we'll use PyDroid application to write our code. And throughout the session, we'll use PyDroid only.
So basically, it has an inbuilt compiler and interpreter, which is basically that if you have this application installed and if you write any Python syntax or Python language code on this, then it will get compiled and your this output will basically you will be able to compile it. You will be able to understand the application understands that you have written in Python and then it will give you the whatever output you are expecting. So okay. So let's just go here and check what is there. Yeah, fine. Okay, so first let me just show you how to create a new file. So this is already there. So what I'll do is I'll just write one statement.
Priya, before you go ahead with this, think we can also ek bar fir se repeat that what they have to download. Because I think a lot of people are not aware, no? Pehle, just clear this with them. And if you want, you can write on the chat also. Because yes, I think that it might not be clear.
Okay, I'll just show you how to download it. I'll remove this app first. So you can get this app on App Store.
This is available on all Android phones also. So don't worry, just go to your store and follow the instructions which Priya is saying.
Okay.
Guys, one quick question. As I said that follow the instructions which Priya is saying, can you relate it to something we learned today?
Yes, ma'am.
What can you relate it to?
Ma'am, the computer will follow only the instructions what we are saying.
She was talking about algorithms and all those things. She said that how will you join the Google Meet call and you follow these steps. So similarly, this is also...
Yes, ma'am, this is the algorithm for the using the application.
Go ahead.
Great. So, okay. So what you do is first go to your Play Store and type Pydroid 3. Okay. So first step is to go to Play Store. Second step is to type Pydroid 3. And then third step is to click on this link. Yeah. So I'm installing it. So you don't have to do anything in this case. Like once this application gets installed, whatever is required, whatever softwares are required for your Python language to run on your mobile phone, that will get installed. Yeah, see, it is installing Python on my phone now. Installing Python as in installing the compiler and interpreter. If I wanted to run Java on my phone, I would have had to download the Java compiler and interpreter, right? Every language has a different compiler and interpreter. You cannot use one language interpreter and compiler to run a different language. Okay, so here we are. So what we will do is, I'll just tell you how to save a file first, how to save and run a file. So this is a simple print statement. Okay, every language has a print statement. Print is how you print an output. Whenever you want to show a result, like we discussed it from the flowchart, right? That you take some input and then you run a certain steps on it and then you give an output. So how will you give an output? You will use print statement. Print statement is when you want to show the user some output, something that your code has done. So here, I will just write hello world. This is it. This is the syntax that Python requires when you want to print out something. And what is this inside print that I have written? This is what I want to display. What is my output? Okay. So here you can see this yellow color is the run button. So if I click on this, it will just say hello world. So what my program right now is just this one line. Okay, I'm just instructing my mobile phone to run this one line of code. And that is what it does when I click on the run button. It will run whatever my code asks it to do, which is displaying hello world at this point. Okay, so I'll just save this now. So you can go here and save. Okay, so I'm just gonna go to internal storage, create a new folder. Python workshop files, create. Okay, and select folder. And now I have to give some name to this py file. So, hello world.
Yeah, so dot guys, py, also. Yeah. Yeah, also, for example, if you have any doubt, you can ask. But if you feel that you want to see these steps again, so the recording of the class will be shared with you. You can always revisit anything you want to for any clarification.
Yeah, okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, as you can see, there is .py, right? Right, you can see here .py, which I have not written. It has already, this .py was already there when I tried to save it. Why is that? What is that .py? That is an extension that you use for Python programming files. Okay, so now if you have ever seen a text document, any document on your system, that usually has an extension of .txt, right? That is just for your computer to understand that this is a text document. Similarly, if you have a PowerPoint presentation, it has an extension of .ppt, right? So similarly, in this case,
yes, ma'am.
Every Python file, Python code file that you create, it will have an extension of .py. Okay, if you do not put .py, the computer will not treat it as a Python file. Okay, so I'm just going to save this helloworld.py. So now you can see this is saved as helloworld.py. So now I'll just go back. It again, yeah. So now it's gone, right? Yeah. So now what I'll do is I'll open it from the system. You can open any file that is saved on your system. Go and check Python workshop file. This is the folder that I had created, helloworld.py, and see the code is there here.
Yeah, and also, you know, I put this on the WhatsApp group, and there's another app called Solo Learn. So in case you have any space issues, if you feel that your phone does not have a lot of space, then you can use Solo Learn app also. It also works similarly. So you can always run your codes there. And the information is there on the WhatsApp group where you all are added. So you can try whatever. You can try PyDroid. You can try Solo Learn. Whatever suits you, you can do that. And Priya, there's another question Amritam is asking on the chat is, in laptop, how do we install Python software? Do you want to address this? Hello, Priya. We can't hear you.
Ma'am, Priya, ma'am is on mute.
You're on mute. Yeah.
Sorry, I don't know how did it
be on mute. Yeah. So phone, everybody's got to know. You can do it, but there's somebody who's asking about the laptop, so I think you can just tell them that.
Okay. So on laptop, right? So you can directly go to your browser and type in download Python for whatever system you're using. If you're using a Windows system, so you can type it download Python for Windows, and it will give you the official link. Okay. So from there you can download it and you can install it on your system. If you want, I'm not on my laptop right now. So if you guys want, I can give you a quick look through how to install for Python and Linux. How to install Python for Windows and Linux tomorrow. Is that fine, Manisha?
Yeah, fine. It's just that I think Amritam, just follow these instructions. And in case you feel there is any doubt you have, then you can ask tomorrow. And Priya can help you with that.
Yeah.
And I think maximum most of you would be using phones. So for phones, as Priya said, PyDroid is one app. SoloLearn is another app. Try using either of the apps, whatever suits you, you can use it. The functionality is same for both of them. So you can just use either of them.
Yeah. Or else I can just give you instructions. I'll put in this document in that this workshop file, right? With the instructions on how to download and install Python on your laptop. Yeah, then you can try it if you want to try it on your laptop. Okay. So this is one way in which you run a code, which is basically you create a file, you write all your Python code in that file, you give that file extension of .py, and then you run it. Or there is one more way of running it.
go to interpreter. Okay, so now what is the difference between interpreter and this code? Okay, so now see, we have been talking about compilers and interpreters, right? I said, like, if you write in your Python programming language, in the compilers and interpreters will convert it and make it into zeros and ones. Okay, but we did not talk about what is the difference between compiler and interpreter. Okay, so basically what does compiler does is, when you write a code, okay, so now this is just one line, fine, I'll write one more line. I'll say print name. Yeah. Okay, so now I have two lines in my file, in my hello world.py file. So when I run it, both the lines are displayed, right? So what this does, what is being happening in the background is, this file is being compiled. What does compilation mean? Whatever code is written in the file is getting converted to zeros and ones, but all of it is getting converted at one time only. Okay, so think of it as, okay, if I want to write, I want to cook something and the recipe is in French. Okay, suppose I want to cook I want to bake a cake. Okay, I don't know how to bake a cake. I opened a French book.
Papa?
Hello?
I'm sorry.
Okay, sorry. So if I want to bake a cake, okay, but I don't know the recipe, then I went to this recipe book, which is in French. Okay, now I have two options in front of me. I can either ask my French friend to translate the whole recipe all together. Okay, so if there are 10 steps, I can ask my friend who knows how to read and write French to translate the whole 10 steps into English and then give it to me. And then I'll read English, because I know how to read English. I'll just read those 10 steps at my own pace. Okay. Or the second step is, I can ask my friend to translate sentence by sentence. I can ask my friend, okay, this is the first line, translate it in English and tell me. Okay, so first you take 3 eggs. You translate this from French to English and tell me, I'll do this. And then you tell me what is to be done next. Okay, I'm repeating it again. It's a bit complicated concept. See, for compilation, what happens is, the whatever code you're giving to the compiler, it will generate zeros and ones all at one time. Here you can see two lines, right? Hello world and my name is Priya. The compiler will convert both these lines into zeros and ones at one time itself. So when you run the code, you get both the output together, because the compiler has converted whole of the recipe that the computer needs to know to generate an output. So in my case, if I want to bake a cake and I ask my French friend to translate the French recipe for me in English, then that French friend converted whole of the recipe into English and gave it to me. So I don't need that French friend anymore. Okay, so once your code starts running, you don't need the compiler anymore, because it has already converted everything into zeros and ones, and now your computer knows what to do. It does not require compiler anymore. I don't need my French friend anymore once I have the whole of the recipe translated to English. And the second case is when you use an interpreter. So what an interpreter does is, it is basically like me telling my friend, okay, you first read the first line of recipe and you convert it into English and tell me, I will do that, and then you move on to next sentence. So basically, first line is, take 3 eggs from the fridge. You convert that line into English for me. I will take out 3 eggs from the fridge, and then you convert the next line for me. So basically, in this case, it would be print hello world. Yeah. So I have just written one line. Okay, now what interpreter will do is, interpreter will convert that line into zeros and ones and ask computer to print hello world. So computer printed hello world. Now it is waiting for my next instruction. So next I will write print my name is Priya. Now the second line also, interpreter converted the second line into zeros and ones for the machine, for the mobile phone, and then it gave me an output of my name is Priya. So now you can see the difference, right, from this and from the code we ran earlier.
So when you are saving your code in .py file, you are expecting the compiler to run on it. You are expecting that the compiler will compile the whole code into zeros and ones. Compiling is basically converting. So the compiler will convert your whole code in one go into zeros and ones and execute whatever is there in that code when you hit on the run button. But here in case of interpreter, this interpreter expects you to give every instruction one by one. Okay, first you do this, first you take out eggs. Okay, I took the eggs out. Then you whip the eggs. Okay, I whipped the eggs. Now you add vanilla essence. Now I add it. So this is how it's happening. One step at a time it will run. Okay, so is the distinction between compilers and interpreters clear? Is the difference clear? What is compiler and what is interpreter?
Yes, ma'am.
Does anyone want me to repeat the whole thing again?
Before Priya repeats it, if you can just let us know if anybody wants to repeat it. But I want at least 5 students to explain what she has talked about. What is the difference between compiler and interpreter?
Difference between compiler and interpreter is compiler is a...
Yeah.
I will explain again.
Ma'am, compiler will run, will process all the lines we are giving at that time. Interpreter will do the line by line. That is the difference between the compiler and interpreter.
Is there anybody who can tell us, apart from Aishwarya and Nisha, like, thank you so much, you guys have been so active in the class. Is there anybody apart from both of them who can tell us?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Shailja, please go ahead.
Compiler means which runs code at a time, and interpreter means it gives the output one by one line by one line, ma'am. One by one.
Okay.
Anyone else wants to try? Anybody else wants to add something here? We can take one last.
Yes, yeah, the difference between the compiler and interpreter is, in the compiler, it will convert all zeros and ones at once, and in the interpreter, it will convert one line and it will wait for the another sentence. Means here, the interpreter will take the step by.
Okay, thank you so much, Renu. Lovely, you also wanted to say something.
Compiler transforms code written into high-level programming language into machine language at once before the runs the code. And interpreter converts each high-level program statement one by one into the machine code during the program is run.
Okay, yeah. Right. Even the compiler will work only when you click on the run button. That is one thing. So, like, only if you instruct the compiler to run, in that case, it will convert the code, right? So, but what happens is when you click on the run button, everything gets converted at once, and then the output is displayed to you. So, yeah, right.
Compiler which run at one time and convert your syntax, you have to put code together, but interpreter is run step by step.
Yeah, cool. Great. Anyone else wants to add something or should we move ahead?
Compiler takes less.
Sorry, can you repeat? Your voice is breaking.
The compiler uses very less time, but interpreter takes more time.
Okay, so now that you brought the time thing into consideration, let's see. Okay, so now it is very logical. Okay, so now if you are compiling the whole code, so if you are translating, if you, for instance, if you are translating the whole thing into from one language to another, you will obviously take more time than if you had to translate only one statement, right? Right?
No.
Yeah. So in this case also, compiler usually takes more time to convert the code and then run it rather than an interpreter, which just has to convert one line of code and run the output. Okay. So this is when...
This can be just related to one small example. For example, you know that in the CodeStars program, you are getting 3 months to learn coding, right? And then you have to cover one topic each day. So you are like learning faster the each topic each day, right? But if you have to learn the entire coding in one day, so then what will happen?
I mean, learning the entire code in one day is very difficult and time-taking task. But learning little by little is very easy and will be very helpful for who's learning.
Yeah. Yeah. So whenever you are learning, you know, try to relate it to your real life examples. And if anything comes to your mind, you can share it with others also. So that is a very, very nice way to learn all this. Yeah, Priya, just go ahead.
Yeah, Manisha. So similarly, when you are compiling a code, the compiler will take more time than an interpreter takes. But then why do you write a PY file? Why don't you put everything in the interpreter? You don't usually do that, right? Because sometimes, for example, if you want to write application for a game, okay, so it will have like what, 1,000, 2,000 lines of code. Now what you, in interpreter, it would be required of you to put all the 2,000 lines one by one, okay? That would be more effort for you, right? To write every line in the interpreter and then wait for the output. And like probably some, like your code might be linked also. So basically, whenever you're writing big code, whenever you're writing a huge amount of code, you usually take the compiler this way. You usually write it in a .py file and then run it via compiler rather than running it in via an interpreter. So interpreter is always used for small things. Like, okay, if you want to add two numbers, you can use the interpreter for that. Because how many lines is that going to take? 3 lines. So it won't take you much effort to write those 3 lines in the interpreter and wait for the output. But if you want to write a 1,000-line code, you usually will write it in a file, in a .py file, and then compile that code. Okay, so that everything runs at one go and you don't have to keep on waiting for a response, like write one line, then wait for response, then write second line, then wait for response. You don't have to do this for 1,000 lines. Okay, so that's, I guess. Okay, and in terminal, okay. So now this is terminal. Terminal, I'm sure you guys are aware of what terminal is. Terminal is there on your laptops as well, right? So in terminal, now if you want to invoke Python, okay, invoke Python as in, see, as you saw here that after going to interpreter, I could directly write Python syntax. I could directly write print statement and all. Okay, but if I try to do that in terminal, it won't work because this is an application, but your interpreter is not still invoked. You will have to call the interpreter. Okay, like when you write in a PY file, and when you run, when you click on this button, that's when your compiler gets invoked. Your compiler is like, okay, I have something to do. I have been called. I have to do this task. Okay, similarly, when in this interpreter, your interpreter is already invoked. It knows that, okay, whatever statement is there, I will have to run it. I have to do the task. But when you go to terminal, even on your laptops, your interpreter is not still awake. Okay. Your interpreter does not know that it has to process some Python lines. So if I write print here, it is not going to work. See, it says a syntax error. Why is that? Because your interpreter is not at, it's not yet started. Your interpreter does not know that it has to do something. So in order to start your interpreter, you will just write Python 3. And now your interpreter is started. Now, if you give hello, it should run. Yeah. So this is basically Python 3. So Python also has two different versions, Python 2 and Python 3. So usually you'll be using Python 3 only. So whenever you want to start the interpreter, you will use Python 3 to start it through a terminal. Okay. Terminal or command prompt for Windows users. And you can only invoke an interpreter through the terminal. You cannot invoke a compiler here because compiler usually runs on like when you are running a complete file, right? So we'll see how to do that as well. So here, so you can directly do using a run button. But if you're working on a laptop and you want to run a Python file, then what to do in that case?
So I'm not sure how many of you are aware of the basic terminal commands. So anyway, while executing, I'll just tell you. So what terminal is basically it's like a look into your system. You can look into the terminal and see what all files are present where in your computer. Okay. So see this storage emulated, right? Here you can see on the left side. This is basically a folder. If a folder is present, and like if you write ls is nothing but it will give you a list of all the files present in this folder. So if I do ls, see, it gave me a list of all the files that are present in my storage/emulated folder. Okay. So now, if you remember, we had created this folder Python workshop files, right? Inside which we had our file. So I'll go inside this Python workshop files. To go inside any folder, what you do is you type cd Python, and you can directly use tab here. So what tab does here is basically it will guess what you are trying to type. When I did cd, which means I want to go into some directory, some folder that is present inside in one of these inside this list. So and I started typing Python and I clicked on tab. So the system guessed that I want to go inside Python workshop files, because that is the only one with Python name, as you can see, right? So
yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so I'll go into Python now, and now I'll see what is present inside Python workshop files. So again, ls is a command to see what all files are or folders are present inside your current directory. Directory is nothing but the current point that you are at. So this left side, right, you can see the folder name, that is the current path, the current point that I am at. Okay, I have to reach to some address and I am at one point somewhere. For instance, if I have to reach Kolkata from Mumbai, I am in Madhya Pradesh, for instance. So this point, right, that this Madhya Pradesh is being shown here on the left side, at what point you are at. So here, as you can see, hello world.ty is present, right? So to run any file, okay, to run any file, you have to give the path of that file, right? So here, either you can go to that path or you can specify address of that path. So here, I'm directly going to this hello world.py, right? I know this hello world.py is present in Python workshop files. So I'm going to this Python workshop files. I'm inside this Python workshop files right now. And now I will run hello world.py. So can anyone tell me, if I run hello world.py from here, what should I expect? What should be the output? Hello world.ty is the file that we created at the start.
Yes, ma'am. It will be written hello world, and below that, my name is Priya.
Okay. And does anyone have any questions in this? Just now we navigated from storage emulated to our hello world.ty, right? So anyone has any questions regarding that? Or anyone did not understand what is this ls or cd that we used?
Yeah, ma'am, I didn't understand.
Okay. So see, basically terminal is a software that is already present on your system. Okay, on your laptop, if you see. Laptop mein, you will have this terminal software. And what this terminal software is, basically it will give you a look over all the files and folders that are present on your system. So in this case, on my system, when I downloaded PyDroid 3, this terminal software also got installed along with PyDroid. Okay, so now if I can see basically what all files and folders are present on my system. Okay, so now what ls does is, see here on left, as you can see, the storage emulated, right, /storage/emulated/0. That is nothing but your current folder that you are at, the current point that you are at. Okay. Now you might know there are folders, and inside folders you can have multiple folders and multiple files, right? So this is one of the folders that I am at currently by default, storage emulated. When I say ls, and files present inside the /storage/emulated/0 folder. Okay, so whatever files and folders are present are listed here when you use ls. So for example, if you are inside my computer folder, okay, my computer is a folder, right? If you're inside that, and if you want to find out what all files and folders are present inside my computer, then you will run this ls command to see what all files and folders are present. I can go to my system files and also check. I can go here and I can go to files and I can check what all files and folders are present on my system. Okay, but will this help me in running the Python code? No, right? Because I have to run the Python code using this terminal only. So I have to find out where my file is, where my Python file is, which I want to run through this terminal only. I have to navigate it. I have to see where this file is in my system. Okay, so when you type ls, you will get a list of all the files and folders that is present in your current folder, the current folder that you are at. Now I knew my file was inside Python workshop files, right? So now I know, okay, I have to go inside Python workshop files in order to see my file. So that's what I did using cd. Cd is nothing but you are going into another folder. From one folder, you are going into another folder which is present inside this folder. So this /emulated/storage/emulated/0 is a folder inside which you have this Python workshop files folder, and inside that I have my helloworld.py file. So I'll go inside the Python workshop files folder and here I have my helloworld.py file. And here at this point I have to run my Python file using some code. Okay, is this understood? Now what is cd and what is ls? Anyone would like to repeat it?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So there are a lot of people who are saying on the chat that they do not understand terminal. I don't understand terminal. Okay. Can you explain again? Ma'am, is terminal installed with Pydroid? So a lot of people are not following this.
Okay, fine. Yeah.
Yeah.
So now in Pydroid, when you click on this button, right, you will find this terminal over here, which is already installed with your Pydroid software only. When you install Pydroid app, this terminal got installed along with it. Okay. And anywhere on your laptop or on your phone, terminal will basically help you in navigating to a file. It will help you go to a specific file. It will just list you all the files that you have on your system, and you can run your programming your programs using terminal basically. Okay, so here you are on the terminal now. Now I want to so to run any file, any Python file, right? You have to first give reference to that file, right? Like if I want to find out if I want to buy something from Kolkata, okay. So I cannot buy it directly from Mumbai, right? If that place is some local place which is not present online or something, I will have to go to Kolkata and buy it, right? I cannot sit at Mumbai and buy that thing from Kolkata, right? Similarly, if you want to run a Python code in terminal, okay, you can run it directly using this run button only. What we are doing is we are seeing how will this run from terminal. Why we are seeing this? Because fine, this button, this yellow magic button is there on your Pydroid 3 phone. But later on, when you will actually go and code on a laptop, in that case, how will you run the file? You will create a Hello World file with all the code. Then what? How to run it? Okay, in that case, you won't have any yellow button. This is just a simulator, right? This application is just a simulator to make the Python code run on your phone. But if you want to write a bigger code, some game code, for example, and you want to run it, so how will you run it on your laptop? You will go to terminal and run it. Terminal is by default installed on every laptop. Okay, that's why it is present here, so that you can run the code. Instead of running it using this yellow magic button, you can run it through terminal. Okay. So can anyone now tell me how much they have understood about terminal? A little bit. Whatever. Is it still not are you still not getting what terminal means?
No, ma'am, can you repeat the question again?
Okay. So, I just wanted to know if you guys know now what terminal means.
Yes, ma'am.
So, software. Joking.
Yeah, yeah. Go on.
Terminal is a software that we have to check our files on my smartphone, so we can check on the terminal the files.
Okay, that is one function. Like, but why are we using it here? Because we want to run our hello world.py file. Okay, so why are we going into terminal in the first place? Because here you can run your code using this button, but when you will actually go on your laptops and start coding, at that point you won't have any PyDroid or anything. Python will be installed on your system. You will create a .py file on your laptop, and in order to run it, you will have to go to your terminal. That's why here, even though we have a run button, we will see how to run this hello world.py file from terminal. Okay, terminal is nothing but a software which you can use to see all the files and folders on your system, and you can execute those files, which is you can execute any Python file or any Java file, any code that you have written in a file and you want to run that file, that you can do using terminal app. Okay, can anyone again tell me how much did they understand about terminal?
Yes, ma'am. Here in the PyDroid app, we are using compiler directly to run the Python program. But while we are using it for bigger codes and laptops, we cannot use this hello button or something. So we have to go to the terminal to find our file, which is always used to navigate to which file we want.
Good. Yeah. And then you will have to run your program using terminal in case of laptop. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyone else would like to say anything about terminal, whatever they have understood? And in terminal also, when we will run that file, right, when we will run this .py file through terminal, even in that case, it will invoke compiler only. Okay? So.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. So from terminal, we saw how to invoke an interpreter, right? We just type Python 3 and the interpreter gets up. Fine. Similarly, if you want to run, if you want to invoke a compiler from your terminal, you will run it using some commands that we'll see later on. So yeah, anyone else would like to tell me more what they understood about terminal? Anyone? Do you want me to explain it again?
Hello. Sorry. I just want to ask tell something.
Yeah.
Guys, if you are taking class now, so if you have any doubts, so you can ask. It's not thing that this is good or bad. You can ask anything. It might be wrong. It might be right. Okay. So you should speak and you should talk. Whatever you think about that, or
yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, anyone has any questions about terminal now? It's fine if you want me to repeat it again, also.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
No, ma'am. It's clear.
Okay, fine.
Great. Yeah, ma'am. We got it.
Okay. So now what we'll do is we'll go to terminal and now we'll run that .py file, okay, as we would on our computer systems. Okay. So as I said, if you want to buy something from Kolkata, I can't sit in Mumbai and buy it, right? I have to go to Kolkata. Similarly, if I want to run a file, I have to go to the file to run it. Okay. I can't run it being in one different folder. So now what I'll do is I'll navigate or I'll go to the folder which contains my Python file. Okay. So as we saw, ls is nothing but to list all the files and folders that are present in your current file. So consider right now I'm in Mumbai.
Okay, there are three routes that can three routes starting from Mumbai. Okay, one to Gujarat, one to Madhya Pradesh, and one to Goa. Okay, so now if I want to see what all options are present for me to go from Mumbai to Kolkata, or what all options are present in general to move from Mumbai, then I'll use LS in this case. I'll get a list of all the options, all the files and files and folders that I have from this point. From the storage emulated point. In my case, from Mumbai, I have three options. I can go to Gujarat, I can go to Madhya Pradesh, or I can go to Goa. So LS will list me all the three options. In this case, in the case of my computer, it will list me all the folders and files that are present in my current folder, the current folder that I am at. Okay. Now next, I know that my file is present inside Python workshop files. Okay, so I will go into Python workshop files, which in if you see this analogy of going to Kolkata, okay, I know that Madhya Pradesh can take me to Kolkata. I know Gujarat can't take me to Kolkata, Goa can't take me to Kolkata. I have to go to the Madhya Pradesh route. So that's what I'm doing. I am taking one step ahead and going towards my destination. That I'm doing using CD. CD is nothing but go one step ahead. Okay. Go to the next folder which is closest to the file that I want to look for. Okay. In this case, it is Python. Python workshop files. Okay. Now, this one thing about terminal is that you don't have to type the whole thing. You don't have to type Python space workshop space files. You can directly type Python and use tab here at the start. So what it will do is it will find out, okay, you typed Python, which means you want to go to one of these folders and files which has a name starting from Python. Then it will see, okay, Python workshop files is the only folder which has name Python workshop files, which starts with Python. So you know that this is the computer knows that this is the folder that you're looking for, and then it will give you that. It will type the whole thing for you. So you don't have to type the whole of the thing. I'll do this again so that you can see it.
Yeah, before Priya, yeah, you go ahead because I think there's just 7 minutes left. So a couple of people asked this. Swati, you asked that you're not understanding the terminal. Are you able to understand it now or you still have confusion? Swati Gaini? Unmute yourself. Please unmute yourself and let us know that did you understand it? Or you can write on the chat also. Turpati Vinu also mentioned that she's not getting the terminal. Can you tell us that you have understood it now? Vemula Rahul, can you please tell us that you've understood it? Usha Rohan Mathi, have you also had a confusion for terminal? Guys, please, you will have to tell us, right? Because if you don't tell us that you've understood or not, it will be very difficult. Yeah, Vemula, yeah.
Terminal is one kind of tool for interacting with our computers,
okay.
Ma'am.
So you got it right. If you have any other confusion, you can write it on the chat, and you can also stop whenever you feel that, like if, for example, Priya is going a bit fast for you and you're unable to understand anything, you can stop and ask or write on the chat. So anybody else has any doubt? Who mentioned that, because there were a lot of people who wrote that they're not understanding terminal. So anybody else who has any doubt still, because we are left with 10 minutes. So I think we can, instead of actually starting something new, we can revise what we have learned till now. Anybody has any doubt?
No, ma'am.
So yeah, Priya, you can go ahead. So we're left with 9-10 minutes. You can decide how to go about it. Like if you want to revise what they have learned till now, or if you want to explain something new.
Manisha, I'm not explaining anything new right now. Let's just execute this Python file from terminal and end this thing here.
Yeah. Because a lot of people were not understanding it, so I just thought that it's better to ask once, because you can then again repeat something, because we have 10 minutes left, right? So that is why I stopped in between.
Okay, fine. If anyone has any questions, they can just come up, like whatever questions they have, and we can discuss that topic. So now I want to go inside this Python workshop files, right? Because I want to access my file. I want to access my hello world.py file.
Yeah, I want to reach to that file's destination. So I can just write Python maybe and then click on tap so that the computer will find out what is it that I was trying to write. This terminal will find out, okay, this Python workshop files is what you were trying to type. I'll just complete it for you. So it will save you some time. And now once I click enter, I am inside this Python workshop files. So if you can see here, I was inside storage emulated 0, but when I went inside Python workshop files, now this left side line has this Python workshop files appended to it. That is because I went into one more folder, right? I went one step ahead. So this is showing me, okay, this is basically a path, a map that you have followed to come till this point, till Python workshop files. Now, if I use ls, which is again the listing the files and folders that are present inside your current path, your current whatever destination you're currently at. So here I can see there is helloworld.py. So now that I am at where at the location where my Python file is, I can now run this Python file. How to run this Python file? Python 3 and the name of the file. world.py and see, it printed hello world for me. Okay, so now I'll just go back and I'll just save this. I hadn't saved my file after typing the second line, that's why only one line got printed. So now every time you change your code, right, you will have to save it so that it gets reflected when you run that file. So now I'll again go to my terminal and I'll follow the same path. Now I have my hello world.py. I'll just type Python 3 hello world. See, again I clicked on tab so that I just wrote hello and I clicked on tab. So terminal completed the whole file name for me. And here it is. Hello world, my name is Priya. So even this, when you type Python 3 hello world.py, right, you're basically invoking the compiler only. You're asking the compiler to convert whole of your file's code and then give you the output of it. Okay. So I think this is it for today's session. If anyone has any questions about what we just performed or any conceptual doubts that you did not understand throughout the session, you can just say it right now. 5 minutes are still left, so we can discuss it. And I also want you guys to go back and try using this PyDroid 3 and try to run one file at least, so that you will be prepared for the next session. So whatever coding we are going to do in the next session, you will kind of know how to start, where to start from. So one more thing, if you want to check out examples, I think there are examples as well in this PyDroid. Like you can see basics, hello world, and open. So see, this is basically giving you at the code, example code here. Similarly, if you wanted to take an text input, so that also, so basically this PyDroid 3 has a lot of examples. Not all of this might be a little complicated, but the first basics, you can see the first 2-3 files if you want to. We'll go through it, we'll go through all the operators and all, but if you just want to take a look, maybe hello world and text input you can take a look at. Yeah, I hope you guys have understood everything that we have covered today during the session.
Yes ma'am, we understood ma'am.
Okay,
you are explaining very clear. Yeah. Thank you ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Class.
So before coming for the next session tomorrow, right? So try to go through this PyDroid app and see one or two. Try to at least, you know, now how does print statement work, right? You know how to write print and whatever output you want. So at least try that. Try to create a file. Try to use the interpreter. Try to compile the file using that run button as well as using terminal. And see, and if you have any doubts, we can discuss it tomorrow at the start of the session.
Yeah, okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Also, okay, people, on your WhatsApp group, the feedback form has been sent. So please don't forget to fill the feedback form, because it's very important for us to know that you have joined this class. So please, please fill the feedback form. So through that form only, we'll get to know that you've attended the class, and that is how we can also monitor giving you the certificate, because there are minimum classes required to get a certificate. So please fill that feedback form. It's there on the WhatsApp group. You have been added.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
China here.